Okay, there's no moderator, so I have to introduce myself. I'm Robert Schuster. I'm doing a talk about cross-compilation practices today. Thank you that you wake up so early and attend my lecture. This talk is a bit like uncharted territory for me. Normally I do talks about Open Embedded or other projects I'm contributing to, but this time I want to do a talk which is not specifically targeted for any for a specific project, but for all projects which have to deal with packaging, and especially in cross-compilation environments. So Open Embedded will benefit from it, but also OpenWRT or maybe MDebian or 2T SDE. So the goals of my talk are that I want to introduce you to cross-compilation techniques and also talk a little bit about cross-compilation build environments. And after that, I will present common issues I see, I've seen in many open source software packages out there. I will present some examples and also a solution to the issues I found. So first of all, what is the motivation for this lecture? I take the perspective of a packager or build script maintainer. I'm myself a contributor to Open Embedded and maintain a few build scripts for especially Java packages. And at the present, there are a lot of patches needed to fix cross-compilation issues in software packages. And patching is bad because every time a specific software package is updated, a new version is released, and you want to add this new version to Open Embedded, you have to adjust the patch, and this consumes time, and this is completely unnecessary because you always do the same stuff. And yeah, I hope that with my lecture, the situation will become will get a little bit better. Let's see. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, the goal is to achieve more out-of-the-box cross-compilation support in FOSS projects. This is the goal in one sentence. Okay, I don't know how much you are into cross-compilation and non-cross-compilation techniques, if you know what's the difference. I'll present it in a simple way. Normally, in a non-cross-compilation context, compiler translates source files into binary files. Okay, very simple. All the libraries and header files that your application or that your software project needs must be available on the system so that the compiler can find them. And the binary executable, which is generated by the compiler, can run on the system that also runs the compiler. As such, the build machine architecture is the same as the target architecture of the binary. In a cross-compilation context, the things are very similar. There's also a compiler which translates to binary files, and also the libraries and header files must be available, everything. But the binary that is created by the compiler cannot run on the system that runs the compiler. That is a major difference. And the reason is that the target machine's architecture is different from that of your build machine. There are other ways of cross-compiling. For example, if you have a Linux machine and build for a Windows machine, this is also cross-compiling, although the target machine's architecture might not be different. But this is not what I'm going to talk about today. So the motivation for doing cross-compilation is that your target machine is usually very limited in processing power, and as such, if you would compile a software package on the target machine, it would take a lot of time. I know of one example. Is the microphone still working? the OpenJDK project, if you compile it on an ARM evaluation board, it takes more than 12 hours to compile. And if I do it on my desktop PC, the whole compilation is done in 45 minutes. So it's a lot of it's a lot faster, and yeah, this is a good reason to do cross-compilation. Other constraints of the target machine, besides the CPU speed, is that you only have a limited amount of memory and low disk space, and usually there's only a slow network connection. You could increase your disk space by using NFS, but then network access makes things slow. So it's not fun to do compilation on a target machine. Okay, this was what I wanted to say about cross-compilation in general. Now I will talk about cross-compilation environments. Cross-compilation environments are projects like Open Embedded, OpenWRT, also MDebian. And the environment provides a cross-compiler, and all the other tools that are involved in building software, like object dump, readelf, and stuff like that. And all these tools are compiled to run on your build machine, but they work with binary files of the target machine. So if you use readelf, which is distributed by your distribution, then you can't inspect binaries for ARM systems, for example. So, and the cross-compilation environment provides designated directories where the shared libraries and header files, which you need when you cross-compile the applications, it provides those directories. Usually this directory is called a staging directory. Every time the environment compiles a library, the shared objects and the header files are copied or installed into the staging directory. So besides the libraries and header files, also scripts and even some binaries are installed in the staging directory, because sometimes configure checks are built like test for the existence of certain files. And when you install binaries, even if you can't run them, those checks are satisfied. In a cross-compilation environment, usually your environment variables are controlled. So they are not, usually there's a filter which removes any environment variables which could hamper your build or the compilation process. And of course it adjusts the path variable, so GCC always resolve to the cross-compiling GCC, and the CC variable is set in a way that it fits to your environment. For example, in Open Embedded, we use C cache and other stuff, so the CC variable actually becomes very long. Okay, if you build the software in a cross-compilation environment, this is about the differences between building software in a cross-compilation environment and in a non-cross-compilation environment. When you build packages for Debian or Ubuntu or Fedora, then these packaging systems follow the philosophy that specific file which contains the packaging and build information, and this file is added to the tarball or to the source to the source of the project of the software. In Debian, you get a source package which has a suffix .dsc, and then there will be a directory containing the roots file, which is a make file, and the control file, which contains the packaging information, which tells the dependencies and what it provides, and also and so on. And for RPM-based distributions, there's a spec file which does the same as what Debian does in its Debian file, Debian directory. And in a cross-compile environment, this this information is maintained separately. You have a file which contains the build information, what needs to be done to get the software compiled and installed, and the packaging information, dependencies, and providing packages is also in a different file. And yeah, it's done like that in Open Embedded, in OpenWRT, all these cross-compilation environment. And there's also a URL in this packaging information files, and this describes where to get the source tar oil. Usually you also have support to retrieve sources from source code management systems. So all this infrastructure has one goal. It wants to automate all the steps. It does downloading the sources, unpacking them, running the configure step, and of course the compilation, and also installation into the staging directory, which I mentioned earlier, and of course binary package generation. And all these steps, as I told, should work without user interaction, so it has to work automatically. Okay, and at this point, I will present the issues I found when packaging software. And I start with a very, very simple issue, and this is custom archive naming. If people distribute source tarballs, they are very creative in naming them. Those archives, and this is not a very important issue, but it's the smallest one. If your project is named Foo, then the usual convention is to use a package name, use a hyphen, then the version name, and then the suffix for the archive. And the sources should be placed into a separate top-level directory, which is also named like the package name with the hyphen and the version number. This is really basic, I know, but not all packages do it like this, and this alone causes a little headache every time you have to update packages. What people usually do is they place source or sources or whatever in the name, or they do not use the version number in the top level directory. Yeah, if you use stuff like the auto tools to manage your source code, then the generation of source tarballs is automated. I think CMake does this also. So the next issue is when you retrieve a source tarball, and you unpack it and you find binaries in it. This is especially this is often done in the Java world, where people put dependent libraries into the source tarball. What you should not distribute is binaries. Scripts are okay. And of course, shared libraries and all kinds of things that make no sense in a platform-independent release. So PyC files, object files, and already mentioned jars. What's acceptable is if you distribute sources which are pre-generated. For instance, if you have WALA sources in your source releases and also provide generated C sources. This is no problem. And also parsers which are made from lex and yak files is okay. Yeah, and one point, the source release should be your primary release artifact. Many projects do binary releases as their primary artifact, and a source release is just an afterthought. And what is really annoying projects which only release a source in a one directory and no makefiles or whatever unscripts to compile the sources. So there's also no information how to build the stuff. Okay. Another common issue is more important for projects which are actually libraries. Those projects should provide a PC file which comes from package config. Package config is a tool which allows querying for the locations of header files and shared objects, and does so by these PC files. And package config has direct support in the auto tools and also in CMake, so it's very it makes the life of packagers easier if a library project contains these files, because they just need to install those files in the respective directory, and then it works. So my advice is, please provide a proper PC file in your library project. So another problem are all automatic checks. What I mean with this is, you have the configuration step in your software project, and in this configuration step, there are checks for libraries and header files and their locations, of course. And quite often you find that these checks expect certain hard-coded locations, like user include foo, whatever, or they try another directory. But this only works on the system of the developer of this software project or some users. But it's not working in a cross-compilation environment, simply because even if this path exists somewhere, there's always the prefix of the staging directory. So this stuff won't work. There's also an issue with a semi-hard-coded path. This is, I will show you an example later where this happened. There, you only have the ability to choose a common base directory, and then the configure script expects some path below this base directory. And this doesn't work if your installation of libraries and headers are different from what the script expects. And again, then patching is needed, and patching is bad. The solution to this issue is just provide configure switches which allow specifying the library and the include file locations separately. Alternatively, you can use package config in the configure script or CMake script to find the library, because then the packagers can adjust the PC file, or yeah, at least there's the proxy in the proxy involved in finding library locations, and the packagers can adjust it by modifying these files. Okay, these were simple problems which are which have no strings attached. A bigger problem in cross-compilation environment is when the compilation step creates helper binaries which are needed during the build, for instance, to create sources, the source files. This issue will be, I talk about this issue from now on, and all the issues which are connected to helper binaries. Okay, is it unclear for at least one? No. Is there anybody who doesn't understand the issue with a helper binary? The problem with a helper binary is that in a cross-compilation environment, the helper binary is compiled for the target architecture. And you can't run it. If you if your target machine is an ARM mobile phone, and you than to compile, for instance, MySQL. I think MySQL has a lot of helper binaries. Then these helper binaries are also for the target architecture, and you can't run them. There's a way out. You could use QEMU, but this is considered cheating because you only pretend to have an ARM machine, and it's not really running. And in a cross-compilation environment, we really want to make sure it works without such hacks. Okay. First problem, when helper binaries are involved, in makefiles, the exact name of the helper binary is used in makefile routes, and there's no way to override the name. So the solution is use makefile variables. So in this example, there's a program named foogen, and in the first example, it's used, the name is hard-coded in the makefile rule, and a solution I suggest to use a variable and then call the foogen that way, and this allows the packager to override where the foogen binary really is. What is nice about this, we don't need patching. This is good. And at this point, the packager only needs to find a way to build the foogen application for the host machine, or for the one that runs the compiler. It's one step in the right direction. The next step is if your configuration script has direct support for specifying the locations of helper binaries. Normally, there's no way to do that because this is what I'm talking about. There's no out-of-the-box cross-compilation support in many, many packages. And as such, the owners of the software project don't think that way. So the solution is very simple. Provide a configure script where you can specify the location of the helper script or helper binary, and then use a variable in the makefiles. It's very easy. I also have an example for this. When we need a helper binary, and we have to provide it as a native binary, so it can run on the system which runs the compiler, we have to build it. And this means we have to compile, we have to run the configure step of the software, but only to compile the helper binary, not the full software. If I want the helper binary for MySQL, I just want the helper binary, not the rule database. And as such, the configure script should only check the dependencies of the helper binary. So imagine you have a GTK application, and this GTK application also has a helper binary. If I tell the configure script I only want to build the I just finished the sentence, and then if you only want to build the helper binary, the configure script should skip the test for GTK because it's not needed for the helper. Your question?
Yes, wouldn't it be a lot easier if we just used a second compiler, like HostCC is used in Linux? So one compiler to compile natively, and one the normal CC to cross compile. So we don't need.
I have to repeat what you said. So either you take a microphone. Do we have?
You can just repeat it now.
The suggestion was to use proper host CC and target CC variables. This is true. Your experience with cross-compiling, you know that these variables exist, but many projects do not, and they just do not use them. So, but it would be a good solution. I know at least one package, it's Phoneme, where this works out of the box. All the helper binaries are compiled with a host compiler, and the real JVM is compiled with a target compiler, and there's no such workaround needed.
I just think that this workaround could cause more work than just changing some CC variables.
Well, but you have to compile things twice when the make files do not support cross-compiling out of the box. You have to run make with CC equals host CC, and then your type binding. Well, perhaps I have an open embedding center view. In our case, it's easier to prepare a separate package which only compiles the helpers, and then use these generated binaries in the second step where you do the real cross compilation. It also is it's cleaner because there's one step where you only create native binaries, and there's another step which is completely separate where target binaries are created. But you're right, if a project wants to really support cross-compiling, they should use host CC and target CC variables out from the beginning. Okay, I think my solution is clear, or is anything not clear? Yeah, my suggestion was to make the configure skip dependencies which are not needed for the helper binary. Now I talk about issues with the helper binary itself. I also have seen this thing. Your helper binary might exist because it creates offsets, and these offsets can depend on the pointer size, and this really cries for trouble, especially when your host machine is an AMD 64 machine and your target is an ARM, because then your pointers are 64 bit and on the host and 32 bits on the target machine. Well, there is a partly solution which involves creating a binary with a hyphen M32 switch, because then you get a 32-bit binary, and if you provide the necessary infrastructure on the host machine, then you can also run these 32-bit binaries on an AMD 64 host. It's also the caveat, because not everyone wants 32-bit compatibility libraries on their build host. And there's also a reason why this is only a partly solution. If your target machine is a 64-bit architecture and your build host is only 32-bit, there's no way to run 64-bit binaries on your 32-bit host. You might ask what a 64-bit embedded system might be. Newer MIPS machines are 64-bit architectures. Okay, another issue with the helper binaries occurs when it accesses system files, like it's under slash sys or slash proc. So they read kernel variables to generate whatever output. In this situation, I suggest something must change in the application, because you really can't fix this. The issue is that the one who writes the software thought that the build machine and the target machine are somehow related, and such they can use kernel variables for the target machine, but doesn't work. And a solution to this issue is that if you really need some constants from your system, then you have to provide an initialization step at the start of the program. But I don't think many programs use this. I know of one case, a Kakao virtual machine in earlier versions had a tool which did exactly that, but they got rid of it by using this constant initialization step. Another issue which is not related to the helper binaries, but to the application itself. Imagine you have a program which needs a path to certain archives or data files, and you need this path twice. You need it once in the compilation step, because you want to access the files to generate something from it, and you also want to place this path in the resulting binary to access the files again when the program runs. So what you have is a build path, a path which is needed at build time, and a path which is needed at runtime. And usually, non-cross-compilation aware projects make no distinction, because they just think about this issue and use the path which was provided at build time. And the solution to this problem, do you understand the problem? So when you run the program, the hard-coded runtime path will point to some file in the staging directory, which doesn't exist on the target machine. This is the problem. So the solution is to add a configure switch, which allows explicitly setting the path which is used at runtime and the path which is used at build time. And the things can be done very efficiently, because when you don't have a cross-compilation environment, you can just, the one who builds the software doesn't need to fumble around with build full path, because it's not needed for non-cross builds. In such situations, the path which is used for build just defaults to the one which is used for runtime. So only the runtime path needs to be specified. Oh yeah, and this is really a pain in the ass when software projects invent their own build system. The worst example I know is the Boost library, which uses BoostGem, and as far as I know, it's the only project which uses BoostGem. The reason why it's bad to use a custom build system is that they have a bad support for non-standard situation. It works on a standard Debian box, on a Fedora, but it does not work when your staging directory is involved and cross-compilers are involved. So yeah, the support for cross-compilation is usually also bad. And there are only few people who really want to compile this stuff, so Google does not help you very much. And other search engines. My solution might be more than a suggestion, because you can't force someone to use a specific software. Try to use one of the major build systems. I only suggest GNU AutoTools, because it has the best cross-compilation support, but also CMake is very good at cross-compilation. It has a very nice way to provide configuration switches. And I know that also SCONS works in a cross-compilation environment, but I'm not sure how well if cross-compilation is supported in SCONS itself. But it works, because it allows overriding compiler variables. Yeah, and if you have questions about how to set up your project, there's no need to reinvent the wheel, because everything has been written down already. One possible source for inspiration are the GNU coding standards, which you can find at this URL. You don't need to follow them in every respect, but they provide a good starting point. And yeah, you will also find my first example there, where it was about the archive naming and the usage of the top level directory, which contains the project name and the version. Okay, how much time do I have? Okay. Normally at this point, this would be demo time, but this day I don't have any software to run. But I want to show you some good and some bad examples. I have an example for where the configuration script only allows to specify a common base directory to search for a library and header path. It's Java SQLite. I hope this is readable for you. Okay, this is straight from the Java SQLite configure script. You only have a configure switch which allows you to set the SQLite directory. And if it's not set, you see it tries some defaults, but this is not the important point. The important point is that you only have one switch, and whatever was given for SQLite directory, the variables which specify the include directory and the library directory are always dependent. There's no way to specify them separately. It tries a directory, looks whether it finds certain files, and if those files are in there, it's satisfied and happy. But this doesn't work if you, for example, and this is the reason why we have in, why we have to patch this in Open Embedded. There's SQLite 2 and SQLite 3, and both of them provide an SQLite .h header file. And as such, we put the header file into a separate directory and still install the library file without a separate directory. And this is when this mechanism failed. Okay. Then here's my example for a custom build system. But I don't show you the custom build system, but a comment from a fellow Open Embedded hacker, which, well, he was the one who first tried to package boost, and this is what he left for the world when doing this. This is a build script from Open Embedded, so I didn't tell you before. Okay, these were two bad examples, but I also have good examples. I'm using the same project for both good examples. The software is Kakao. It's a Java virtual machine. And they have very good maintainers which understand cross-compilation issues. And everything to be happy with in regard to cross-compilation. They follow the advice to have a separate configure switches to specify a build and runtime path. I'll show you this. At this location, you have the definition of a configure switch, which allows setting the location of the Java class library. You don't need to understand Java to understand this. Kakao needs the location of the class library at compilation time to compile its own classes, and when the virtual machine is built, it also needs to access the class library because the Java program which the virtual machine wants to run needs a class library. So this is exactly where you have the situation where the path is needed at compilation time, and the path and the same files are needed at runtime, but the path is different, and so you have to provide two configure switches for this. So this is the one which sets the runtime path, And this is the one which is only needed for cross-compilation purposes and allows setting a special path which is only used at build time. And at this point, you see that if it's not used, then it defaults to the runtime library path. So this is what happens when people are not cross-compiling Kakao. And the last good example, very simple one, it allows, Kakao also has a helper binary, the Kakao header file generator, which is normally compiled for the target machine, but if you if you have a separate build step and compile Kakao H for your build machine, you can have a second compilation run, the real cross compilation step, and there you can specify where you have compiled, where your Kakao H binary is. And this is only needed in cross compilation context. So it defaults to the Kakao H binary, which is generated during the build. Okay, these were my examples. A short summary. You have seen what cross-compilation environments do and how they manage the build, that the automation is a great the goal of these environments, and they want to save you a lot of work. And these cross-compilation environments strive for out-of-the-box cross-compilation support in their software packages. When this out-of-the-box support is not there, patching is needed, and I told you patching is not so nice. I've presented cross-compilation issues in software project out there. You've seen that these things were only examples, but you can find them in many projects. Patching is needed. And I presented solutions to the to issues. There's always a way out for these problems. Okay, that's it. Thank you for attending my talk. Are there any questions? Excuse me, it's a little bit too quiet for me.
Yes,
I have to repeat the question.
Yes, okay, sorry. What's happened to me on numerous occasions is that some package config script or a git tool generated something or other causes the link step to fail because the linker is passed minus big L slash user lib as a library search path. Now that's the host library, not the target library. So it will find the libraries in there, then it will say invalid binary file exit.
Yeah.
Because it's an x86 library that was expecting an ARM library, and of course it doesn't work. Now the only way I found around that is to put wrapper scripts around almost everything and look for these troublesome switches and adjustment. I've not found a way to stop libtool from adding these flags.
So when, I don't understand the question, so you were not satisfied with package config, with what was
far from it.
Okay, so he was not satisfied with package config because the package config file itself was not very well maintained. Is this right?
Well, I don't know the root cause of the problem, but it's sometimes it's package config, sometimes it's libtool, and it's got LA files that cause the problem.
So package config.
The end result is inevitably that it tries to look for libraries in my host build systems slash lib, sorry, when it should be looking in, well, the target image is big.
When it comes to package config, two parties are involved, the tool itself,
which is
very simple. Broken. and the package config files itself. And what I also know from fellow open embedded hackers is that these package config files cause trouble because they are not generated correctly. They contain wrong paths, and then libtool is fooled in taking native binaries. Yeah, but I still tell it's better to use package config than to use custom library and header file search logic, especially if people use hard-coded paths like slash user include.
Well, the thing is, the cross-compiler is generally configured to automatically look in the correct locations without being told. So it, when I run my cross-compiler, I configured it to look for header files in slash blah target slash user include and libraries in target user lib. So I don't need to specify those on the command line at all. So there's no need for package config in the first place.
So your suggestion is to that the compiler should be smart enough to...
I'm saying that the compiler is smart enough.
Is smart enough. Okay. That's an interesting suggestion. Maybe we should talk about this later on. I want to hear more of this. There was another question.
Yeah. How hard is it in your experience to get cross-compilation patches accepted with the average upstream order?
Well, I have not tried to... there was I added patches, cross-compilation support patches to Kakao, but this was not very difficult because I'm already in this Java community thing. But one reason for doing this talk was that people understand what the cross-compilation issues are. So when we provide a patch, which for instance allows setting a runtime path and a build path, those who are not using cross-compilation do not understand why this is needed. So this was one reason to do the talk, to make it more clear what cross-compilation issues are. So yeah, my my impression was that it is difficult because of the non-understanding. But I also have good examples in the Kakao project. Is there another question?
Yeah, so I have another issue with the autoconf and the autonome. Lots of times I run into a problem where a configure script tries to run a little test to determine whether some library or other is available. Right? That's a good way to check that. Now what they do sometimes is they try to also run the executable that they produce, and if it fails to run, as it would if it's compiled for ARM and I'm on an x86 machine, then say, nah, library doesn't exist, bear out. Alternatively, they'll say, oh, you're cross-compiling, let's assume it doesn't exist.
Yeah, this is a very weak approach.
If I'm lucky, I can go through the million lines of configure scripts. Because they're looking at the high level configure script isn't usually enough. You have to find the, look at the expanded version, to find the variable that it sets and override that externally.
I have to repeat what you say for the recording. He mentioned that autoconf has a very specific way of dealing with cross-compilation, with the cross-compilation situation. Usually it wants to run a certain binary, process the output, and then decide what to do. But when it finds out, oh, we are cross-compiling, it knows, ah, I can't run the binary, just assume something. And this is causing trouble. This is what you wanted to say.
Yes, pretty much that, yeah. As built-in, usually defaults to the answer being no, whatever the question was.
Yeah. Okay, is there another question?
One more issue I've had with it.
We can also talk to...
So, the specific one I was a bit puzzling for a while, but figured it out, was like something needed to have so many BFD and things on the target system. Building GDB or something like that. And it was failing to link for some strange error messages. It turned out the BMutils installation, when I did make install, it sets up symlinks somehow. And they were hard, absolute symlinks that were pointing to my host system, not relative within the target system. So that some libraries were picking up. It would have been correct with the root file system rooted at virtual route. But when cross-compiling, the compiler followed the link and landed in my build of systems native library locations. And again, what was mismatched architectures to build them, of course.
And whose fault was it, this? What is the fault for this?
Well, creating,
whose program is responsible for the wrong path?
I'm not entirely certain where this absolute similarity came from, but I had to make some scripts to find them all and fix them.
Okay. Well, another question?
You mentioned the queuing mode cheating, and I'd like to know whether it what would be the burden of putting the whole build and the whole thing inside queuing. So, not using cross-compilation at all,
yeah.
One would use the faster network, the faster CPU speed would fit a trade-off for the emulation, and all the good things. So what would be the problem with that?
And the question was whether it is not acceptable or not desired to use QEMU for running the whole compilation and building step inside inside an emulation. Well, I'm not here to say you can't do this. Actually, it's done this way already. Scratchbox works this way. Scratchbox does very strange things. It runs a few binaries natively, and only a small number are emulated. And there's another project called Mamona, where they take this step to another level. In Scratchbox, for instance, you usually do not run the compiler in the emulation. The compiler is a cross-compiler. But whatever helper binary is generated runs emulated. And in Mamona, they even run the compiler in the emulation. And I know that with the mixed approach, there were issues when stuff like Python is compiled. I don't know the specifics, but they mentioned it. They had issues at this point. Well, it is another approach. But for me it looks like a workaround. I think the solution would be a good solution would be when there is a good cross-compilation support in the package. And I've presented some issues which are happening out there and also solutions to them. So it's not impossible to do it. And in fact, there are really big applications and big projects which support cross-compilation out of the box. I mentioned Phoneme, the Java virtual machine for mobile phones and PDAs. And with this piece of software, which is not simple, I had the least trouble to get it cross-compiled. At one point, I knew in my first approach to package Phoneme, I disabled the JIT compiler because I saw a helper binary is generated to create offset tables and whatever, and thought, leave JIT compiling out, then it's easier to compile. When it worked for the first time, I changed the variable to switch on the JIT compiler, and everything worked out of the box. The reason was, for this was that the creators of the make files for Phoneme correctly used host CC and target CC, but not all makefiles do this. I think the time's out. Yeah, thank you.